Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning to all of you. After the hectic yesterday, we will start afresh with my lecture on sustainable production technologies in banana. Of course, I will be touching the sustainable as well as the high-tech also, because banana, last 20 years, we have moved from sustainability to high-tech cultivation also. For the information of some of the delegates, this is our main building in the university, constructed in the year 1906, one of the oldest monument. This is the icon of Coimbatore. As far as the sustainability is concerned, we aim for prosperous farming communities, at the same time environmental stewardship, but farm profitability. All those three things we taken into consideration under sustainability. And when we start cultivating banana under intensive cultivations, some of the negative effects we come across is the soil erosion because of the repeated cultivation of the things, which leads to loss of organic matter and biodiversity. Of course, chemical, biological and physical imbalances are also on the way. So key issues in banana plantations, the soil salinization. The typical example is the Trichy Cauvery Delta area. Though banana is grown extensively in this, and Cauvery, the lifeline of Tamil Nadu is flowing nearby, the soil salinity is increasing year by year. Soil compaction, then nutrient imbalances also. Because what happens is, many of the farmers, they do not apply the required potash for banana, which is otherwise a very huge removal of potash from the soil. So it leads to other problems, other things. Then of course, incidence of soil pathogens and other things are also coming across in this way. So the soil health, now that is the prime motto of our government of India as well as government of Tamil Nadu, to protect the soil health. Because of the intensive cultivation in almost all crops, soil health has gone down, and every effort now we are making to rebuild our soil health. And normally earlier and all, weeds are considered as unwanted things. Now we insist that even the weeds should be converted into, recycled into organic way, build-up of the soil. Thereby, we can improve upon the soil health. Then coming to the commercial varieties. Though yesterday also I was in my speech, I told you Tamil Nadu is known for polyclonal cultivation system. We grow nearly 20-25 varieties. But of late, in the last 10 years, we are concentrating only on some of the commercial cultivars, but Tamil Nadu has got typical three type of cultivations. One is under wetland cultivation, where we have water facilities, then garden land and hill banana, and the western ghats, taking advantage of the rainfed situation, we grow some. So each cropping system demand specific varieties. In the case of wetland, we have this Puvan, Rastali, Mundan, Karpurvalli. These are all the main varieties. But of course, now apart from the Grand Nine, the commercial varieties are only two, namely Naipuvan, which are main area, and also industry also, they are supplying plant material only in this kind of varieties. Then taking into consideration of the requirement to replace the susceptible Naipuvan, in our university we have developed, as early as 1998 we started working on this hybridization, and yes, variety CO2, which was released this year 2020, and I am very glad that the fruits which you have eaten just now is our CO2, and this variety is very good in terms of taste and also keeping quality. Besides, it is resistant to nematode and built and other things. So I have already appealed to some of the companies, tissue companies, to come forward, make an MOU and take the mother plants so that the planting material can be made available to all the farming community. Then this is the field view. You can see the other side, the Naipu one showing the symptoms of the nematodes, whereas and no symptoms in the field conditions or field conditions like this. Now of the hybrids which are all in the pipeline and in the advanced stages of testing is the last one, H5131. It resembles like Puvan and tastes like silk. So this variety is also now under advanced stages. The next one is 96 bar 7. It also resembles like your Pisang Awak, resistant to nematode and tastes excellently like your Pisang Awak or the Karpuravalli, and also it keeps its taste is also good. TS is more than 18 degree. The second one from the right hand side, NPK 0 to 01, is a triploid AAB, which is just like the POM group of variety and also resistant to wilt and nematode, which is very suitable for the hilly areas of our Thade. Of course, H212 already is here as CO2. Regarding the planting material, of course, majority of the farmers are still using their sod suckers, and here sod suckers, when you use, we have to select the uniform sized varieties. Tissue culture banana, in the last 20 years it has made a very tremendous growth, and now Grand 9, Naipu 1, as well as the your Nendran, these varieties now most of the farmers are propagating to tissue culture, and the cost is also now 18 to 20 rupees. Government is also trying to give subsidy for the promoting this growth. And thanks to NRCB, they have developed another method of rapid multiplication that's called macro propagation, wherein these lateral buds are made to suppress the apical dominance, and thereby you do multiply these plants. This technology will be useful to quickly multiply a latest developed variety, and within about 5 months you can get planting material. From one comb you can get about 14 to 15 plants within a period of 40 days. And when you try and plant these materials as a planting material, there is no difference between the bunch weight and crop duration, indicating that this is another alternative of multiplying plants through macro propagation. And the another technology is the somatic embryogenesis, very good approach taken by the NRCB. And my request is to the director NRCB is, you can also take up our new variety and start multiplying, and your university is prepared to buy the material developed by the ECS so that the materials will be available to the farming community at a faster rate. And the trials conducted at the NRCB shows that the ECS developed material or the TCS derived material, they do perform very well as compared to the common method of propagation, namely sucker. There is no difference in the bunch weight or number of hands. That means it is also another alternate method of multiplying the planting material by ECS derived or TCS derived material. These are all the pictures developed by this method. And population maintenance. Since the last 20 years, TNAU as well as NRCB, also under the ASRB, coordinated research trials, many centers, they have dabbled with different kinds of population for different varieties. And these are all some of the systems I have mentioned. This Pyro system is advocated by NRCB. TNAU, we are advocating high density planting system wherein the row to row spacings are kept slightly wider, and in each pit we can go for more number of plants, that is 3 suckers or 2 suckers. The 3 suckers are good for certain varieties like Cavendish and other groups, whereas for 2 suckers per hill we have to go for varieties like Neipuvan, Rastali, other things, because therein we found that our aim was to get maximize the yield. At the same time, bunch weight should not also get reduced. Normally, under the high density planting system, the bunch weight will go down. That is the concept, but it is not so in the case of certain varieties. That's why we are advocating this technology. And here you can see, in a single bit, we are keeping 3 suckers. Also, we can plant 3 TC plants also. We found that this is the best technology to increase the population, thereby productivity can be enhanced. You can see 3 suckers at a time, and also here the propping is not required, instead tying all around so that one plant will support the other plants like this. We can go. The pad row system also advocated by the ICR NRCP, it is also another alternative like this. Then coming to the cropping system, banana is a one crop which can be grown in all kind of cropping system. It will serve as a intercrop, it can be serve as a mixed crop, it can serve as a intermediary crop in a multi-tier system, all these because of its growth. And only thing is, certain varieties will perform very well under each situations. Under the mixed cropping system, banana, if you take it for shade, this is the shade crop for banana. In fact, 1960s and 70s and all the lower Panli hills, the planters are very, very happy because every week they get money out of their hill banana as a shade crop, with which they will meet the cost of labor and other things. The net revenue from the coffee is the full revenue they realize per year. Now the situation is slightly changed because of so many other development, other things. So it's a very good mixed cropping system. Even on coconut oregano plantations in Andhra Pradesh, they go even grow under our oil palm. In any cases, it will fit in the mixed cropping system. And multi-tier system of cropping, this has been standardized under our Central Plantation Crop Research Institute, wherein the palms or coconut will serve as the first tier, or arecanut, then second tier will be our banana, tapioca, turmeric, ginger and garlic are under the third tier. So, but here one requirement is that you have to individually take care of the nutrient requirement of each plant, otherwise there will be lot of competition for nutrient and the total yield will be slightly get reduced. The multi-tier system of cropping, sometimes banana itself is serving as the top tier, lower down you can have Dioscorea, elephant putium, turmeric and ginger. So as I stated earlier, that banana is a crop which can be fit into any kind of cropping system. Only thing is, you have to choose the other crops or companion crops depending upon your objective. Intercropping also, lot of trials have been conducted and shows that it will fit in with any system. But only thing is, now South India has got lot of coconut plantations. Certain varieties will alone perform under the shade. So there is a need to screen some of the varieties which will perform well under coconut or arecanut plantation. That kind of research we require. Coming to the water requirement, banana is a water-loving plant. It cannot be grown under rain-fed situation except certain varieties like hill banana. There also we receive adequate rainfall right from April to March, say April to December. Here in our university we have determined the water requirement of banana very critically, and we found if there is a deficiency in the water during vegetative period, it affects the rate of development of leaves, consequently flower duration, flowering, everything will be affected. If there is a water deficit during the flowering period, yes, certainly it will affect the leaf growth and number of fruits. During the bunching period or the yielding period, if there is a water deficit, it definitely affects the fruit size and quality. even at the time of harvest, if they you don't give the proper watering, then it will affect. So why I'm giving a stress on those things is, it cannot be grown as a rainfed crop. It requires water, and that is the advantage of using micro irrigation also. And university have standardized for different varieties. Roughly in the vegetative period, you have to give water between 5 to 10 liters of water depending upon the cultivar. Flowering period, it should range from 15 to 20 liters. Bunch development phase, very critical at that time, 20 to 20 liters per water per day. And drip irrigation, the last 20 years, it has made tremendous improvement in the cultivation of banana using this drip irrigation. And I'm happy to say that Tamil Nadu, next to Maharashtra, has occupied more area under drip irrigation. Our government also has received many awards because of the micro irrigation implementation in larger scale. And our earlier trial shows that when compared to the conventional one, if you go for drip irrigation, there is a saving of water, there is an improvement in the yield, besides you get additional yield nearly 46%. That's why it now people who are going for commercial banana means, they go for drip-based system of irrigation for the banana. As far as fertigation is concerned, our university has first time standardized the fertigation requirement for banana based on the uptake pattern. See, banana is a crop which will take more of potash followed by nitrogen, and least requirement is for phosphorus. And also the stage wise also is very important. So that based on the uptake study, we have devised our fertigation schedule, which is the most success behind the fertigation technology. We have standardized for crops like varieties like Nendran, Neipuvan, Red Banana, besides our Cavendish group, namely Robusta. So herein, this is the schedule we are recommending, right from 9th to 9th month after planting, if it is in the case of our sucker derived plant. If it is your TC plants, you have to start fertigating from the 4th month. The simple reason is, the TC plants, you have already developed, well-developed root system. Whereas the sucker-derived one, it will take nearly 45 days for the parent sucker to develop the active roots. And again, you can see the distribution of nitrogen in the early days, phosphorus only in the early, very early phase, but potash till up to the last. Actually, our study shows that fertigation, even after harvest, you have to retain the plant, which will supplement the developing suckers for nearly 60 days. Then only you have to remove the plant, because that is the living matter that supports the growing sucker. Thereby, your return crop will boost up the yield like anything. And this is the experiment wherein we conducted whether fertigation is very useful under high density planting also, where we grow 3 suckers per plant when compared to the NP means normal planting. You can see normal planting, the bunch weight is 38 kilo, where a high density planting wherein 3 suckers are planted, there is a slight reduction in the bunch weight, but overall tonnage you can see it is more because of the more number of plants, more number of bunch weight, thereby it is giving higher yield per unit area. And of course, such kind of things varies with the variety to variety. We have tried with our red banana, wherein red banana, when we go for higher planting density, it is not reflecting on the bunch yield. So, and another thing is, also for the Neipuvan, we found that 3 sucker is not giving very good yield, whereas 2 suckers per plant per pit is good under drip fertigation things. So you can see the success of growing Neipuvan under drip fertigation. Then integrated nutrient management. In fact, our experience in our university, we have got nearly 110 years old permanent manorial experimental plot, wherein Two seasons we raise continuous crop, either sorghum or this maize. For the last 110 years, we had the data wherein it has clearly proved that integrated nutrient management is best than go for 100% NPK or 100% organic manure. So that's why we are sharing that experience with other crops also. So in the case of banana also, we are recommending INM, and wherein apart from recommended doses of our fertilizers, we will have to go for farmyard manure, then azospirillum, phosphobacteria, all those things will all supplement our INM practices. Then this I am specifically giving a machine developed at Rahuri. Also our TNA also developed very recently one shredder. Normally what happens, the pseudostem which is containing almost all nutrients, potash 5% and nitrogen 1% like this. This, in the case of wetland system, we can get it easily decomposed. In the case of hill banana also, it can be easily decomposed because of the moisture. What happens in the garden lands, our farmers used to remove it thinking that it is a menace. Or sometimes they burn it, just like the Punjab and Haryana, they are burning the sugarcane. So that should not be done. It must be crushed, thrashed, and it must be allowed to get decomposed in the field itself, because it will give lot of nutrients get recycled. So to enable that, only the machine is there. It can be operated through a tractor which will shred about one pseudostem within about 1 minute. That by then, if we apply some of the biodecomposing agents, we can recycle the manures. The use of neem cake, I need not emphasize. This is Indian product, and it becomes a part of our culture. And use of neem cake, it reduces the nematode population, and also now it is neem coated urea is available. Neem is also purely apply along with the manures, etc. So also we can also mixed with our Pseudomonas fluorescens, a biocontrol agent which will reduce our impact of the fusarium, etc. So biofertilizers for growth, our university has standardized and come out with this AM fungi application, phosphate solubilizing bacteria, azospirillum. What I am trying to emphasize here is INM with biocontrol agents will be able to give very good growth and sustain the production of the banana. Then the sulfate of potash, a product of Kessel industry, German, we used in our banana to improve the quality. It is very costly, so we are used as and recommended only as a foliar spray. 1.5% of the sulfate of potash, when the last hands open, if you give at 15 days interval 2 to 3 sprays, that it improves the fruit size, quality, and color is excellent. The marketability is also good. So this also we have proved in almost all commercial varieties, and this can, now it is going at the recommendation. So considering the deficiency of many nutrients, now NRCB has come out with the Banana Shakti. Yesterday also it was released in the meeting, and it goes like this. Now likewise, all our institutes and universities should develop crop-based micronutrients. This banana, this IHR developed very good. Similarly, our university has developed for Pulse Wonder. University has developed for sugarcane also. Now recently we have developed one cassava tonic, tapioca tonic. When it is sprayed on the plants, it suppresses the effect of the CME virus incidence, and 20% additional yield we are getting it. So this kind of technology is very good for banana also. And another chemical, another multiple nutrient material, polyhalite, which is pruned very well in Turkey. We are going to test it. We have got MOU with the company IPNI, and we will be shortly using it, because it will reduce the dependence on potash on banana. As you told, as I told you earlier, banana requires 330 grams of banana, very costly potash application. So this polyhalite we are going to try. Probably in the next year we will be able to give the preliminary yield trial. Integrated weed management, I need not emphasize on this. Clean cultivation, we are using this mulching or the use of this our bio vegetations will be of much useful, or sometimes some field they are growing for intercrops, or use of chemical weedicides like diuron, paraquat and gold, all those things are being practiced by many farmers. Intercultural operations, certain things are very, very essential for a banana to get a sustainable yield. Desuckering is a very important character, and it also desuckering varies from variety to variety. For example, in the case of Nendran or your plantain is a poor suckering, number of suckers will be very less, whereas Neipuvan number of suckers will be more. That means desuckering has to be frequently done, and this earthing up operations is very essential, propping to keep the bunches intact, we need propping. Other intercultural operations, the leaf pruning, especially when you are growing under the near that canal areas, other thing, very humidity is there, the Sekodaga leaf spot incidence is more. To reduce that, you have to go for leaf pruning, bunch cover, then bunch trimming and de-naveling. These are all some of the operations which we recommend in the banana cultivation. Bunch cover, TNAU has recommended, and it is being adopted by many farmers. 4 to 6% ventilation is required depending upon the season. If it is summer, more percentage. If it is winter, lesser percentage of ventilation is there. The bunch cleanliness is also good, and also it advances maturity by 7 to 10 days. Red tuning technology. Normally, since many people are going for tissue culture banana, the cost is also high. Certain varieties respond to retuning. In the case of all Cavendish, when compared to the plant crop, retun crop give the higher yield. So this retun technology is very good. Only thing is, we must check the presence of nematodes. And here also drip irrigation, fertigation, and use of tissue culture banana, that will support our maximum you can keep it for 3 years. But certain varieties like hill banana, with my experience I have seen 40 years it is still giving returning without any problem in Kodaikanal Hills. There are some clumps which I marked in 1979, still it is there, still it is free of budget of banana. So maybe some of the inherent endophytic bacteria will be playing a key role. So it is up to the pathologist to look into these kind of things. Then integrated disease management, which I will be only sparingly touch because there are some special sessions I am on this. So banana wilt, our Trichoderma, Pseudomonas, Bacillus and all, largely you have to use it to substitute this. And NRCB has developed one special train, NRCB 1, which is also used in Rastali to reduce the incidence up to 80%. And this is the integrated method we are recommending: chemical, cleaning, injection, calm injection, and even the capsules application and the calm will reduce the incidence. And recently I must appreciate one of my students, Dr. Thamodaran, has done extensive work in North India. And in Bihar and UP, that race 4 is a big problem, and farmers have almost given the hope of raising this Gram 9. But this ICR Fusicon, which contains Trichoderma and some Bacillus species, with which the farmers are happy. In fact, the day when I visited, there was a field day, and farmers are after him to get that Fusicon. And this Fusicon is doing very well, and they are supplying the material from the research stations, that is IAS, that is the Lucknow Center, to that farmers field regularly. And after knowing its performance, there is an inquiry from our Lower Panli Hills for the hill banana. There is also incidence of this particular farmer, Mr. Jay Prakash, is a progressive grower. He started using this. His version is that Fusicon is also doing very well with race 1. and our university is still working on this. We have to come out with some technology out of this. And another thing, yesterday Dr. Krishnakumar was also asking whether BBTV anything there. One of our student, Dr. Kavino, is there here. For his PhD work, he has worked on biopriming using this endophytic bacteria isolated from the BBTV infected area of Hill Banana. They have isolated Chavo strain, chitin, and also the endophytic bacteria, other things. When we use this consortium, the banana is able to survive under the heavily infected BBTV area, and we are also able to get better yield and other things. So that's why now this tissue culture banana under Hill Banana means it has to undergo the bio-hardening or bio-priming technology like this. So Sigidaga leaf spot, integrated pest management, and this liquid formulation, Dr. Bhatanaman, I think, will be highlighting. This is another spiraling white fly. This is a big challenge to the coconut in South India. And here the problem is farmers are indiscriminately using the pesticides, which unfortunately kills the useful insects also. So now TNAU is educating the farmers through many awareness program that if there is an infection, there will be our good predators are also there. Same thing is also affecting banana and also leading to that Sigidaga, sorry, sooty mold and other things. This management, the nematode management is not now. Whenever the nematode is there, integrated approach is there. Dr. Sundarajan is there, he is an expert. And this growing of this marigold and other things are there. But my appeal to the nematologists, there are many repellent biospecies are there. That you have to exploit in the days to come, then only you will be able to develop very good technology. So banana from the backyard, now we are shifting to in a level of commercial one. Our aim is to take it to the national and the global level. So in that case, we have to go for high-tech cultivation in the days to come. Thank you for the opportunity given.
Thank you, Dr. Kumar. Complete overview of banana. It's like reading a monograph. Thank you very much. Any quick questions? A couple of...
I am Pandiraj from Tenin district. I am growing red banana and G9 banana. You have suggested desucking, that is removing the extra, will it affect the main roots of the main crop? How many times it has to be done, and at what stage, third month, fifth month, seventh month?
Yeah, actually the desuckering method is most important. Better remove at the bottom level without affecting the calm,
main crop,
calm side.
Roots of the main crop.
What happens is if you disturbance do some injury in the calm side, likely spread of the disease is there.
Yes.
And also you can apply sometimes using this 2,4-D, other things also if you apply on the growing point,
yes.
That also do desuckering purposes.
How many times it can be done at what interval?
Normally 1 month.
First month age.
After 2 months, stop.
Say for example, G9, 8 months, bunches come out.
Yeah.
So, second month, fourth month, 6 months, something like that?
Yeah. After first desuckering, every month it is had to be done, yes. Till about up to 6 months.
Six.
Then afterwards you can allow the one sucker,
okay.
Entire removal, other things like that.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr.
Thank
Chairman.
Thank you, Dr. Kumar. Yeah. For